Hey, what's up everyone? So it's been a long time since I did a video with a guest, but I'm super glad because today I have as a guest a former SwiftUI engineer at Apple. Welcome, Natalia.
Hi, Vincent. Thank you for inviting me.
Thank you for being here. And I'm super excited about this video because we are going to talk about APIs that you've actually worked on yourself and are now part of SwiftUI.
Yes. Hi, everyone again. So today I wanted to share some examples of sheets and popovers in SwiftUI. So I'm quite passionate about this topic because I worked on the presentation APIs when I was working on the SwiftUI team at Apple. And what we call presentations are model presentations in SwiftUI, such as sheets, popovers, full screen covers, and even alerts and dialogues, because they are presented modally and they cover the rest of the app. But today I will focus mainly on sheets because they're the most generic and most flexible presentation API.
Awesome. So I'm really looking forward to your explanation. And before we start, I just want to mention that you wrote a book about the new APIs in SwiftUI, and we'll be talking about it in more details near the end of the video. Okay, so let's get started and let's switch to your screen, Natalia. So let's talk about model APIs in SwiftUI.
Yeah. So let's quickly take a look at what a sheet is in SwiftUI. We can present a sheet using the sheet modifier, either with isPresented Boolean binding or item binding. Here in this example, we can see a Boolean binding, which controls the presentation of the sheet. The content of the sheet is self-contained, and it works like a preference and floats up the view hierarchy, and then gets presented and it's on the scene level. So on iOS, we only have one scene on iPhone, so it just presented on the window level, as we can see in the example. The user can swipe to dismiss the sheet, and it's provided automatically by SwiftUI. When I say this sheet is self-contained and floats up as one instance, one part of the content, I mean that if we apply any modifiers inside the sheet, they usually just affect the content of the sheet, whether they're environment-based modifiers or preference-based modifiers. We can see this concept better if we experiment with the toolbar, for example. So the toolbar is also preference-based modifiers. Here it floats up and gets intercepted on the navigation stack level. We can see that it's applied outside of the sheet, and we can see the button here in the navigation top trailing corner of the navigation bar. This is the default location where SwiftUI places toolbar buttons, unless we specify otherwise. We can try moving this inside the sheet and see what happens now. We see that the button disappeared, and this is expected because the preference will float up, but will get intercepted on the presentation level. And when we present the sheet, we still don't see the button because the sheet doesn't contain a navigation stack. So there is nothing inside the sheet to handle the button for us, nothing to intercept the preference of the toolbar. We can experiment with another modifier, also preference-based, which is the preferred color scheme. If we apply it like this outside of the sheet, it affects the entire app. So now the app turns dark, including the sheet, because the preference again floats up and gets intercepted on the application level. If we move this modifier inside of the sheet, we can see that the app as a whole is not affected anymore, and the color scheme gets intercepted on the presentation level. So I think some people might think it's unexpected, but it's good to know how sheets work to be able to diagnose issues if the app doesn't behave correctly or to get the desired result when we just want to modify the color scheme of the presentation.
Yeah, I see what you mean, because when we look at the code, and if we like base our intuition on the indentation level, we might think that the color scheme is going to like bubble up all the way to the navigation stack, but actually no, because even though the text is inside the sheet, it is completely, like you said, self-contained, and it's going to basically like stop bubbling at the level of the sheet modifier.
Yes, exactly. So we can sort of reuse this knowledge now to be able to present multiple sheets at a time. I think this is one of the lesser known features of SwiftUI, so I will show it quickly here too. We can present multiple sheets one at a time, no problem, independent of where we place the sheet modifiers. There used to be a bug for some time in here where we couldn't change sheets like this.
Yes.
but it was fixed, I think, a couple of releases ago. And now if we change the sheets this way, we can show one sheet, dismiss it, show the next one, dismiss it. But this way we can't show one on top of the other. For example, let's move this button to show the second sheet on top of the first one. So now we show this first sheet, but we can't show the second one. Like if we press the button, nothing happens. And this is because we already have an active presentation on that level. And the other one just can't be presented on top of it. But we can work around this by moving that sheet inside the first sheet too. And now we can show one sheet on top of the other. So when we dismiss the second one, the first one is still there and we can dismiss the first one. This is maybe a more of a rare use case, but sometimes it can be useful. For example, such example is present in the system iOS calendar app. When we create a new calendar, we can see one sheet on top of the other. Yeah, and this works this way because we can think of the sheet in SwiftUI as like a view control in UIKit. So it can present new presentations itself. Like it works the same way with sheets, popovers, or full screen covers. But yeah, that's a neat trick that we can use.
Yeah, and I think I might have used this trick recently where I had a flow to create a team that was in a sheet. And then there was a link to invite people that I wanted to show in the UI activity controller. And so you need to show a model on top of an existing model. And it comes up like easier than you would think.
Yes, exactly. It's good to know how it works when you need it, even if you don't need it all the time. And the last topic I wanted to cover today is the new API introduced in iOS 16, which serves for presenting resizable sheets in SwiftUI. This was a long-awaited API. And I worked on it during the last year when I was on the SwiftUI team. So the new API includes the presentation details modifier that we can place inside of the sheet again, and it will affect this particular sheet. So we can choose what details we want to use. We can use the large or the medium, which are system ones, or a more customizable detent like the fraction, where we specify the fraction of the full sheet that the detent covers. We can see that the user can now resize the sheet from different sizes. This is the fraction one, this is the large one, and then they can go to the small one too. So the order we provide the detents here doesn't matter because it accepts a set. And SwiftUI will make sure that the user can resize the sheet in the order that makes sense for this particular presentation, from like the smallest to the medium to the biggest one. This API includes more different customization options. We can customize the drag indicator, show or hide it. We can create custom detents, custom structs that conform to the detent protocol for more advanced use cases. This API doesn't cover all the functionality that the equivalent API in UIKit covers at the moment, but I think it's still a nice addition and makes the sheets more customizable. One other thing I wanted to mention is the detents works for popovers. The detents modifier works inside popovers too. Like for example, we can replace the sheet with the popover, but the popover actually is shown as a sheet in narrow sizes, like on the iPhone, for example. So the detents this way will also be respected, just like with the sheet. And on the iPad, the popover would be a regular popover, with the anchor, and the detents would be ignored because they don't make sense inside the popover. Yeah, we can also see that the drag indicator gets added automatically because we provided more than one detent. Yeah, it was quite a challenge working on this API, even though it like seems simple and like most of the SwiftUI APIs, they seem simple to use, but it requires a lot of work to actually design them this way. And what we had to think about as a team was how would like this functionality work in the context of SwiftUI? How can it provide the best functionality by default? Like for example, we don't require you to add the drag indicator yourself. We just add it for you when it makes sense, when the sheet is resizable. And for example, like if we only support a medium detent here, we will not add the drag indicator because the user can't reset the sheet anymore.
Awesome. I think I definitely agree with you that this API is a very welcome change, because I remember using SwiftUI to display, once again, UI activity controller, and we could only display it in large. And at first, you don't notice that something is different, but you see something feels a bit off. And then you're like, yes, mm-hmm. I'm missing that part. And so now we can display the activity controller with the medium detent, like UIKit does it by default.
Yeah, for sure. And we can like create custom detents, which can be very small or almost that large, and just to match the design we are looking for.
Yeah, definitely. Like, I didn't know about this fraction detent that gives us a lot of control, actually, over what we want to show. And that's pretty nice to have it.
Yeah, this was new in UIKit as well. So we were looking to like match as much functionality as possible in both frameworks when we work on that.
All right. So thank you a lot, Natalia, for this explanation about the sheet modifiers and how to use them. I think I've definitely learned a couple things today.
Yes, of course. It was a pleasure to share it.
And so as we said in the intro, you've also written a book about the new APIs of SwiftUI. And I was wondering if you could tell us a little bit more about it.
Yes, of course. So the book is called Integrating SwiftUI into UIKit Apps, and it showcases various ways to add SwiftUI to existing UIKit applications, such as presenting SwiftUI in a separate view controller, embedding SwiftUI views into existing UIKit controllers, using SwiftUI in collection view sales, and building widgets in SwiftUI. It also covers how we could start migrating the app from UIKit to the SwiftUI app lifecycle and reuse some of the existing UIKit code inside the updated SwiftUI app. And as much as I enjoy working with just SwiftUI, I understand that many developers are working with existing UIKit projects. And I wanted to help developers to take advantage of the new features, such as Swift charts and lock screen widgets and the slightly older widgets, home screen widgets in the existing UIKit projects. Like, they don't have to rewrite the entire app. They can just incorporate parts of SwiftUI inside the existing app.
That definitely looks super interesting, especially like for me. I'm exactly in that you said, like integrating SwiftUI in an already existing UIKit app. So I think I will definitely want to check it out. And of course, the link to learn more about the book is in the description. You just need to scroll down if you want to check it out also. All right. So once again, thanks a lot, Natalia, for being with me for this first video with a guest in a long time. It was a pleasure having you.
It was a pleasure to be here and to talk about SwiftUI APIs.
Thank you all for watching the video, and see you next time.